Yesterday, a number of people came to me and said, even if they have not attended any other session, they'd make sure that they are here today because Justice Nariman was speaking. And from your presence here, I'm sure all of you are looking forward to his address. May I request the honorable dignitaries to please grace the dais, Justice Nariman, Justice Sikri, and Mr. Chandyok. Honorable Mr. Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman. He did his schooling from Mumbai, then graduation from Sri Ram College of Commerce, law from Faculty of Law, LLM from Harvard, and joined the bar. Justice Nariman was made senior counsel by the Chief Justice of India at the young age of 37. Having practiced law for last 35 years, he has over 500 reported Supreme Court judgments to his credit before he was elevated as a judge of the Supreme Court of India on 7th July 2014, directly from the bar. As on 30th January 2018, some exercise was done, Justice Nariman has written 150 judgments. He has been part of 7 judgments delivered by the Constitution benches between 2014 and 2017, 3 landmark judgments relating to right to privacy, freedom of speech, and triple talaq. He was part of the bench which struck down Section 66A of the Information and Technology Act 2000. I'm sure a lot is known about Justice Nariman. There's one fact I would like to bring to your notice. Justice Nariman was ordained priest from Bandra Egiari at the tender age of 12 years. He has written the critically acclaimed book, The Inner Fire, Faith, Choice, and Modern Day Living on Zoroastrianism. The book is a complete analysis of the Gathas, which consists of 238 verses, and is for everyone who wants to gain a deeper understanding of the purpose of life on earth and what happens to mankind after death. He has passion for and deep knowledge of Western classical music, he has great interest in and avid reader of history, philosophy, literature, and science. But for the fact that he took to the legal profession, he could have been a priest, a historian, a philosopher, or a musician. That's Justice Nariman for you. May I request Justice Nariman to please address the gathering.
My dear friend, Justice Arjun Sikri, Justice Chandyok, my good friend J.P. Singh, and all my good friends here. Mahatma Gandhi, the founder of our great nation, is remembered twice a year in January and every January. This is the 70th year since he was assassinated. He is remembered first on 28th and 29th January when the beating of the retreat, which is a very beautiful ceremony that takes place every year, and he is remembered because his favorite hymn, Abide With Me, is what is played in his remembrance. It's a very beautiful hymn and it's very beautifully played. Those of you who haven't seen the ceremony must do so. The other day on which he is remembered is the most unfortunate day, 30th January, when he was assassinated. Now, 30th January is a day in history which for astrologers and numerologists is one of the most cataclysmic days for this reason. Great changes take place by either the coming into existence of a new leader or by the deaths of some very great people. The first 30th January in history is in 1649, when King Charles I lost his head. And the result of his losing his head was that Parliament, which was till then a truncated institution in England, came to the fore. The second date, which was cataclysmic again in history, was 30th January 1933, when Hitler came to power. That again, as we see, has led us to the Second World War and at least 55 million deaths. And the third and equally cataclysmic day was when the father of our great nation was assassinated. Mahatma Gandhi, to me at least, is not only perhaps one of the greatest individuals that ever walked on this earth, but was one of the greatest mediators ever. He was a mediation expert. Look at the mediations that he conducted and see their success rate. The first thing he did was to try and reverse successfully thousands of years of discrimination within his own community, which he successfully did, because the untouchable, or Harijan, a word coined by him, was now at last put upon the Indian map. And our constitution has done much to follow his great ideals in seeing that they are reinstated. Look at what he did, Quay, throwing off the British yoke, a second great mediation feat, and having achieved it through completely non-violent means. The third other great mediation exercise was Hindu-Muslim amity. This he did his very best for, and perhaps did not succeed only because at the end of the day, like Napoleon in 1813, he could not be everywhere at once. Having said this, what was his technique? What was the mediation technique that he used? His technique was the prayer meeting at which he read copiously from the Bhagavad Gita, from the Quran, and from the New Testament in particular. The idea of these prayer meetings was to tell those present, and those present would then go and tell others, that in point of fact, there is very little difference in the ethical parts of every great religion. No religion tells you to be violent. No religion tells you to be greedy. All religions say that as you sow, so shall you reap. How you reap, when you reap, where you reap are matters of detail. But the essence is the same. And this, I think, was his greatest contribution to mankind. And this contribution goes deep back and has deep roots in the history of our great nation. Our nation has harbored so many refugee peoples, and over thousands of years, I belong to one of them. It has harbored the Jews, it has harbored early Christians, it has harbored the Buddhists up to a point, and it certainly has harbored us, Parsi Zoroastrians who had to flee Iran. Let's begin with the Jews first. As all of you know, the Jews originally were divided into 12 tribes. You had the northern tribes, which were put together and called Israel, which consisted of 10 tribes. In fact, all these tribes were really progenitors of 10 sons from two wives and several concubines of Jacob, who himself was called Israel. And these 10 tribes banded together and made what was called the Northern Kingdom. And the two southern tribes of Benjamin and Judah ultimately banded together and made the country of Judah. The split occurred after King David, who ruled over the combined lot of 12 tribes, and after King Solomon. Solomon was the great man who built the first temple in Jerusalem. And it is at this Holy of Holies that all Jews came to pray. This Holy of Holies was destroyed about 500 years later by Nebuchadnezzar, but then his destruction took place about 300 years after the Northern Kingdom itself was destroyed. The Northern Kingdom, which as I told you consisted of these 10 tribes, was destroyed first by the Assyrians in 718 BC. And the first great dispersal of the Jews worldwide took place as far back as in 718 BC. They dispersed all over. And in fact, a number of them came and settled in the valley of Kashmir and as far as northeast India. In fact, DNA tests show that there are certain tribes in northeast India which date back to the Northern Kingdom dispersal. And Israel today has recognized these tribes and asked them to come back as Jews. Coming back to the destruction of the temple destruction takes place at the time of King Cyrus of Persia. And Nebuchadnezzar comes and utterly destroys it and enslaves the Jews and takes them over to Babylon. Now, when they were thus enslaved for about 30 years, Cyrus the great king of Persia comes not as a conqueror, and this is what is very important, but as a person who liberates. Now, who does he liberate? He doesn't merely liberate the Jews. He liberates the Babylonians themselves from the yoke of a king called Nabonidus. And he says all this in what is called the Cyrus Cylinder, which fortunately for us is a little clay tablet that was buried at that time and excavated in the year 1889. And the tablet, I have in fact a translation of the tablet. And the tablet which is put in the UN hall at New York in a pride of place as being the first declaration ever of human rights reads thus. It's worth reading and I want all of you to listen carefully. He says, I am Cyrus, king of the universe, great king, powerful king, king of Babylon, etc., etc. He says, when I went as a harbinger of peace into Babylon, I founded my sovereign residence within the royal palace amid celebration and rejoicing. An invader, huh? Celebration and rejoicing. Marduk, the great lord, not Auramazda, Marduk, the Babylonian great lord, bestowed on me as my destiny the great magnanimity of one who loves Babylon. And I every day sought him out in awe. My vast troops marched peaceably in Babylon, and the whole of Sumer and Akkad had nothing to fear. I sought the welfare of the city of Babylon and all its sanctuaries. As for the population of Babylon, who, as if without divine intervention, had endured a yoke not decreed for them, I soothed their weariness and I freed them from their bonds. Marduk, the great lord, rejoiced at my good deeds, and he pronounced a sweet blessing over me and my son, Cambyses. Then he goes on to say, I sent back to their places, to the city of Ashur, Susa, etc., whose shrines had earlier become dilapidated, mark this, the gods who lived therein, and made permanent sanctuaries for them. I collected together all of their people and returned them to their settlements. And the gods of the land of Sumer and Akkad, which Nabonidus is named now, the ex-ruler, to the fury of the Lord of the Gods, had brought into Shwana, that's a particular place, at the command of Marduk, and I returned them all unharmed to their cells in the sanctuaries that I made to make them happy. May all the gods that I return to their sanctuaries every day before Marduk and Nabu ask for a long life for me and mention my good deeds and say to Marduk, my lord, this is Cyrus the king who fears you. The population of Babylon call blessings on my kingship, and I have enabled all the lands to live in peace. What a fabulous declaration. And this by a king who lived 2,500 years ago. Now this great king does not tell you in this document that he did much more than this. He freed the Jews also from Babylon. And this we are not told by him. We are told by 6 books in the Old Testament, particularly the book of Ezra. And mind you, the only person who is called anointed of the Lord, which is an appellation used for prophets, other than prophets, is King Cyrus in the Bible. So they say Cyrus, anointed of the Lord, did this and did that. Now, not only did he free the Jews from Babylon, but he did something more, affirmative action, as he tells you in his great document. He said, I promise that I will rebuild your temple with our funds. That decree was made, but unfortunately, by the time Cyrus died, this could not be achieved. His son Cambyses came and went, and then Darius I, the great, comes. And Darius is reminded, and all this we are told from the Bible, the Old Testament, Darius is reminded that, look, your predecessor has promised that he will rebuild our temple. So the Darius says, yes, if my predecessor says so, I will do it. I am bound to do it. But where is the decree? So everybody looked around for the decree, and ultimately somebody found it. And when they found it, Darius the Great, following the decree, built the second temple out of the Persian royal treasury funds. The interesting thing about this temple is that the Wailing Wall, which stands today and which is so sacred to the Jews, was part of this original temple. It was an outer wall of this temple. And if you see the Wailing Wall closely, you'll find that the lower part is distinct from the upper part. The lower is the older part, which was built by the Persian funds. And the upper part is part of Herod's third temple, which was built 2,000 years ago. So, we have an instance in history of the Jews being helped by a different people from us, from this country, and having their temple rebuilt. Unfortunately for them, in the year 70 AD, a Roman general's son, he became emperor later, Vespasian, and the son followed him as emperor, Titus, utterly destroyed the second temple, so to speak, after which the Jews have been dispersed all over throughout history. Now, that second destruction is what left this one particular wall, which they therefore regard as being the only thing that remains of their temple, which is why it is so sacred today. Now, coming back to our theme, the Jews who were dispersed as a result of the destruction of this temple in 70 AD went all over the world, but also came here. And when they came here, they had sanctuary here. And they had sanctuary in such a way that they were undisturbed for 2,000 years. Because of this, and recently I went to Ahmedabad and went to the synagogue there. And I was told, because it's exactly opposite our Aghiari. And I was told there by the gentleman in charge that the only soil that exists in a little urn in Jerusalem is Indian soil. Why? Because this is the only place that has harbored and kept the Jews. and has never done anything to disturb them. It's a remarkable thing. And in tribute, they keep Indian soil there. That the soil of this nation, this great nation, is the only nation which has harbored them and not damaged them. This is as far as the Jews are concerned. Then we come to the early Christians. We know, as a matter of history, that one of the 12 direct and immediate apostles, St. Thomas, who was called Doubting Thomas in the Gospels, because he was the only one who wanted to see the resurrected Christ and actually see the wounds in the body. This apostle was sent out by Christ to Persia. And having preached in Persia, he went all the way to Taxila, preached in Taxila, and there is historical evidence that he converted a king called Gondopheres, who was there in Taxila. And coins were struck, apparently, with Thomas on the other side. And from there, he came by the land route all the way through Kerala and finally into Madras. And he was martyred in Madras. His tomb is in Madras. And this great man brought with him early Christians, converted some of the local people. And the earliest Christians, therefore, that the world can boast of, really belong to Kerala and Madras and can trace themselves back to this time. They are called Syrian Christians because a lot of them came from Syria later, in 325 after the Council of Nicaea. But what is important is that just like the Jews, this great nation harbored them as well, and they were left absolutely undisturbed in worship as well as to till the soil and live as citizens along with everybody else. Apart from these two great communities, you now come to the Buddhists. Gautam Buddha originated from here. He preached here. And ultimately, a very great emperor, and this is the first of our great emperors, the second was Akbar, converted to Buddhism, Ashoka. And this is about 2,250 years ago. And after being an extremely bloodthirsty tyrant, it is said in the Buddhist chronicles that he had at least 99 of his brothers killed before he came to the throne, which of course modern historians say is not correct, but he had 6 brothers which we killed in any case. He then had this huge war against Kalinga, which is Orissa, and shocked by the huge slaughter that took place, ultimately converted to Buddhism. Now, this great emperor also has left rock edicts in the manner of the great Achaemenian kings in Persia. And Rock Edict 12 is something which, again, like the Cyrus Cylinder, is worth reading out to you. Because it's a document which is so relevant today and speaks of the brotherhood of mankind in an extremely beautiful way. This Rock Edict, translation I'm reading, says, "The beloved of the gods, the king Piyadasi," he was called Piyadasi, "honors all sects and both ascetics and laymen with gifts and various forms of recognition. But the beloved of the gods does not consider gifts or honor to be as important as the advancement of the essential doctrine of all sects. This progress of the essential doctrine takes many forms, but its basis is the control of one's speech so as not to extol one's own sect or disparage another's on unsuitable occasions, or at least to do so only mildly on certain occasions. On each occasion, one should honor another man's sect, for by doing so, one increases the influence of one's own sect and benefits that of the other man. While by doing otherwise, one diminishes the influence of one's own sect and harms the other man's. Again, Whosoever honors his own sect or disparages that of another man, wholly out of devotion to his own, with a view to showing it in a favorable light, harms his own sect even more seriously. Therefore, and this is the beautiful word, concord is to be commended, so that men may hear one another's principles and obey them. This is the desire of the beloved of the gods, that all sects should be well informed and should teach that which is good, and that everywhere their adherence should be told. The beloved of the gods does not consider gifts or honor to be as important as the progress of the essential doctrine of all sects. Many are concerned with this matter. The result of this is the increased influence of one's own sect and glory to Dharma. What a beautiful, fabulous edict this is. Our cardinal value of fraternity in the constitution couldn't be better explained than through this edict. And this is exactly Gandhiji's method. What is the method? The method of mediation that he used. His prayer meeting at which readings from every great text are read aloud so that people may understand that mankind is one and that the ethical portion of every faith is the same. Metaphysics may differ, and we are broad enough in this country to take it, to take any metaphysics into account. You may believe in God, you may not believe in God, you may believe in a million gods, you may believe in the spirit, you may believe in whatever you like, that's your belief. No problem. But your belief must then translate itself so as to interact with your fellow men. And when you interact with your fellow men, it is very important to keep in mind that every great faith warns you and tells you whatever you do, there is an equal and opposite reaction to. It is either in this world or in the next. But be very careful. So you sow, so shall you reap. Now, having done with the first great emperor, we now come to my own people. We have spoken about how this country, this great nation has harbored the Jews, how it has harbored the Christians. The Kisse Sanjan, which is a document of 1599, written by a Parsi priest like me, tells us that sometime in the 700s, late 700s AD, after we faced persecution in Persia, our people went into the hills in Kohistan in Persia for about 100 years and lived there. When we could no longer do so, some of us came to Hormuz, which is a port. A lot of us went elsewhere. And from Hormuz, we set sail and came to the little island of Diu. We lived in Diu for some 19 years. And then were emboldened enough to come to the mainland, which is Gujarat, Sanjan. And there are two conflicting versions of what happened then. One version is the famous version of the bowl of milk and the sugar, for those of you who don't know. Apparently, our chief priest was told that this land is full. And he was told that it is full and cannot have you people, because a bowl of milk completely filled to the brim was sent to him. He used his presence of mind and pulled out a little sugar and put it in the milk. Now, unfortunately, even though this is a lovely story, it remains a story. Historically, apparently, what actually happened was that we were able to, our priests were able to, study Sanskrit and composed 16 Sanskrit shlokas, which they thought they would then tell the priests in the mainland, and the priests would then appreciate that we were only a breakaway group from the motherland, which has now come back. And those 16 shlokas are extant. You can read them today. And they make very interesting reading. They keep saying that, look, we believe in the worship of fire just as you people believe in the worship of fire. our women are fair, tall, beautiful, etc., there will be an adornment to this nation, etc., etc. And it seems that the priests there were taken up with this and gave us sanctuary on five conditions. The five conditions were that you will adopt the Gujarati language, which is what we've done. My mother tongue is Gujarati. You will marry only after sunset, because that was the local custom. We still marry only after sunset. You will till the soil, which means that you will look after yourselves. No charity here. You will have to do this by yourselves. Your women will wear the sari, and above all, you will not bear arms. Now, each of these conditions we have faithfully adhered to. And we continued as small farmers until we came to the eye of the great emperor Akbar. And this is where we come to our second great emperor who lived in this country. Emperor Akbar was larger than life. And though illiterate in a sense, he was more learned than all the priests put together because he had a fabulous memory and he soaked in whatever was told to him. This great person not only attempted to get together all the peoples of this country, but was a great builder as well. He built Fatehpur Sikri, which I'm sure a lot of you have seen, which is a fort of such a dimension that it tells you that its builder must have been somebody colossal. And indeed he was. He built the Bulan Darwaza, which is on the side where Salim Chisti's tomb is, in commemoration of a victory that he had in Gujarat in the year 1572. And what is interesting, at least to me, is that on this Bulan Darwaza, there is an inscription in Persian. And the inscription is remarkable because the speaker is Jesus. And he says, and interestingly enough, this what is stated in this inscription is not found in the Bible. So it is from some other tradition. The inscription says, Isa, that is Jesus, peace be upon him, said, do not build houses upon this earth, but build bridges to the next world. For this earth is but a moment. Spend it in prayer. The rest is unseen. Beautiful. Huh? And this, the very fact that he put this up showed how much it played upon his mind. Again, as you all know, he probably had the first council of world religions, the Ibadat Khana. And every sect, apparently, was heard and attended that council. You even had Sabians, a little known sect, who come from Yemen. You had the Charvaks, materialists, from here. And you had everybody. You had Jews, Christians. In fact, you had three Christian missions. And Akbar made best friends with each of the leaders of these missions. In fact, he made best friends with a Jain Muni, who greatly influenced him, called Hirivijaya Suri. He made best friends with our chief priest, Mayarji Rana, who went there. And he followed a lot of Zoroastrian precepts. He made best friends with Rudolf Aquaviva, who was one of the Portuguese Christian fathers who came down. So much so that he instructed those fathers to instruct one of his sons, Daniel, in the Christian religion and bring him up as a Christian. He, in fact, embraced every faith and took the best from all of them, including Ahimsa, Gandhiji's Ahimsa, which he took from Jainism. And he had weeks where he turned vegetarian and expected the court to turn vegetarian because he turned vegetarian. This great man, therefore, again, was an early preceptor of what Gandhiji did 500 years after him. Not only did he have this great council of world religions before him, in which every faith was heard, but then ultimately, he tried to found a new faith. Din-e-Ilahi, he called it Din-e-Ilahi, which is the religion of God. And he thought, perhaps idealistically, that if he were able to bend this country into believing in one faith, there would be complete harmony. Of course, being extremely great, he didn't force this upon anybody. Also, he did not insist that you abjure your own faith in order to join this. Now, unfortunately, it had no clergy, it had no body, so to speak, it had no rituals, it had nothing by which it could last beyond Akbar's lifetime, which is why it died. But the concept itself was a very great one. The concept was the ultimate brotherhood of everybody in this country and bringing everybody together. And this therefore brings us back to Gandhiji's great method of mediation, which is the method of the prayer meeting. I wish somebody resurrects this and does it again today. You have a prayer meeting at which the Hindus can be told about the Quran and the Muslims can be told about the Gita, and they can discover that there is not much difference between the two. The Christian New Testament can also be thrown in to again show you that there is not much difference between the two. And this brings me to another one of Gandhiji's favorite readings at this prayer meeting, and which I will read out to you just now, from the Sermon on the Mount. He loved the Sermon on the Mount, and you'll see why. The Sermon on the Mount, which is found in the Gospel of St. Matthew, is Jesus's most sublime and beautiful teaching, and reads thus. Jesus tells the multitude, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are they that have been persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall reproach you and persecute you, and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. If you are the salt of the earth, and the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is then for good for nothing to be cast out and trodden underfoot. Ye are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on the stand, and it shineth unto all that are in the house. Even so, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Think not that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I came not to destroy, but to fulfill." What beautiful words. Equally beautiful is the hymn, "Abide with Me," which I spoke to you about. Three verses from this hymn will again tell you why it captured the imagination of the great mediator. First verse says, "Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, oh, abide with me." Now verse 5. "Thou on my head in every youth did smile, and though rebellious and perverse meanwhile, thou hast not left me as I have left thee. On the close, O Lord, abide with me. Beautiful. This also brings back what the great Cromwell said just before the Battle of Naseby. He put his sword down, he put his helmet down, looked upwards, and said, O Lord, do not forsake me, even though I may forsake thee. And now paragraph 7, one more from this great hymn. I fear no foe with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no weight and tears no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still if thou abide with me. The prayer meeting, therefore, and the importance of telling the majority community in this country and vice versa that the Quran, for example, states in chapter 2, verse 190, that Allah does not like those who are aggressors. People who have to defend themselves may do so, but do not be the first to be the aggressor. Verse 256, there is no compulsion in religion. Very important to know this. Equally, chapter 24, verse 33, Allah knows the plight of a prostitute and will judge her with compassion. Now, these are readings that should be made known to everybody. And it is important, therefore, to stress what is good in each religious text, instead of picking up something out of context and then stating that therefore the entire religion is bad. Another very interesting thing is that the Quran is really a book of comparative religion. Why? It goes back to each of the Abrahamic faiths. It believes in Judaism. It speaks of all the great Jewish Old Testament prophets and extols all of them. It speaks of Jesus as a great prophet. And above all, even though it may ultimately state that he did not die on the cross, it does state that he was born of a virgin. It does state that he had the power of miracle. And does give him the status of a very great prophet. Now, if all this is seen in the correct light and correct perspective by everybody, and above all, what is seen is that the ethical part of the religion is exactly like the ethical part of every other religion. As you sow, so shall you reap. We would be getting or going towards the great goal of fraternity, which our constitution preaches. The fundamental duties chapter also tells us, and they are Gandhian principles, that first and foremost, we must believe in the principles of the freedom struggle. This is very interesting and very important. We must believe that we obtained freedom through non-violent means. Very important. Equally, we must believe in the brotherhood and sisterhood of humankind. Now, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, which is one of the greatest symphonies ever written, has in its last and final movement Schiller's Ode to Joy sung. And that Schiller's Ode to Joy is nothing but how custom has divided humankind and how we must get together as brothers. And this great message by this great German composer is so looked upon by the Japanese nation that Beethoven's Ninth, because of Schiller's Ode, is ceremoniously played every New Year's Eve to remind everybody about the overall brotherhood of man. Equally important is it through these prayer meetings to tell our Islamic brethren and the other minorities that the Bhagavad Gita is a theistic text. In fact, in chapter 7, verse 23, it specifically says, those who wish to go to the gods, go to the gods. Those who wish to come to me, come to me. There's this distinction made. It also goes on to teach very lofty and great ethical principles. It tells us specifically that outcasts, this is very important, are seen in the same light by a person who is realized as any other person. It also tells us that women and Shudras, as much as anybody from any caste, can attain heaven. Now, if all these things were to be told, not only to persons who believe in the Gita, but those who know nothing about the Gita, I think that we would become much more cohesive as a whole. And above all, if you mediators have not read these great texts, I must exhort you to read every one of them. Because as a mediator, the tools of compassion, justice, psychiatry are all found in these texts. And they will give you such a beautiful idea of why you are here and where you are likely to go, that your mediation skills will be honed. And may you all, therefore, ultimately, become somewhat like the great mediator, Mahatma Gandhi, through these great texts. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, my Lord. I don't think I at least can speak today after hearing you. I do remember a time, Lord, when I was additional to you, Lordships, being the Solicitor General of India. And in that short span of time, what I learned, I don't think I learned during my days, even in the bar. I don't know whether Lordship would remember it or not, but I do remember it and I keep repeating it. He led me in a matter and I went up to him. I came from abroad and I went up to, the room was right next to mine, to say I had argued this in Delhi High Court. And probably we lost, the government lost it. So these are the 7 points. He said, 2 are good, rest you can argue. In the corridors of Supreme Court, in the next 5 days, those 2 became 7. Every time I would get a hug from His Lordship and say, no, and ultimately it led to this, I will argue, and the Lordship will come only at the end. This is my Lord Justice Rohinton Nariman.
Just don't believe it, I don't remember it.
I'm not putting a Lordship on oath, don't worry. I just told both my Lord Justice Sikri and Justice Rohinton just when we were sitting there, even if 10% of yours, what you both have, what you both give us, could be imbibed by the bench and the bar, future of this country is very, very good. And I'm sure that what you have taught us today, what you have desired from us to do so today, we at Madhyam will take it forward and assure you, my Lord, that we shall ensure that each of our mediators in capacity building this position learns, reads them, adopts them, so that they also become mediators, what you today put a picture before us. Thank you so much, my Lord, for all that. I don't know whether Justice Sikri would like to respond or not, but let me request him to at least say a few words.
Don't believe him either, he's a very good friend.
No, as far as response is concerned, I think you have observed, all of you as we, when we were in awe, all mesmerized listening to him. Could anybody see the kind of memory he has? No, not a single paper, except what he read those three quotes, that's all. Otherwise, I don't know, I was asking him once, how you remember all these names, how you remember all these years in the history when you say, and many times all those quotes also. And I said that some of these names, maybe when you see from continental Europe, Italy and other countries, even Japanese, etc., they sound so difficult. And his reply was, more difficult the name, easier for me to remember.
The more interesting them.
More interesting them. See, there's one very interesting, actually it was really a very inspiring talk for all of us, because I consider myself to be a mediator in that sense, because I belong to mediation family. About Gandhiji, everybody, and whenever we talk about Gandhi, his quote on mediation, that after he settled the matter and how he found himself to be, that he got that sense that it is such a good thing and all that, and where he said that I lost nothing, not at least my soul, etc., that quote. But there's a book by Stephen Covey, The Third Alternative, and where he speaks of synergy when the two persons sit together along with mediator and they try to resolve their disputes by dialogue. And as I said day before also, that look, it's always we think I versus you or me versus you, so two sides, and why we don't think of the third alternative. And in his entire book he talks of this third alternative, this synergy, and very interestingly he quotes another story of Mahatma Gandhi and in support of mediation, which is this story, you know, everybody must be knowing about it. If you remember when he was in South Africa and he was traveling in first class, he had taken ticket first class, he had bought that ticket, first class ticket, but as no blacks or Indians were allowed to travel first class, he was thrown out of the train. And there, how Covey analyzes his mind, he kept sitting on that platform when he was thrown out whole night, as to what should I do. He was a lawyer and he had gone there for practice. He thought that first alternative is that I just forget this, because this is happening to all of us, to blacks, we can't help it. Second alternative is that I go to the court, file a case against the authorities, that look, once I had this ticket, or first class ticket, and when I was given this ticket, there was no reason for any of these authorities to ask me to step down from this first class. And he thought over it again and again, but then ultimately he decided the third alternative. Says that no, if I forget, then naturally this injustice which is prevailing, it would be perpetuated. If I file a case, I may win the case, but then it would be giving justice to me only. What happens to such incidents which take place day in and day out? And therefore he thought of the third alternative, that no, maybe taking the path of ahimsa, non-violence, but I should have a dialogue in that sense with the authorities and tell them that what you are doing is wrong, and that would be good for the entire humanity. And that is the path he chose after deliberating for so many hours that night. And that becomes, in a way, the ethos of mediation. And that is what we should remember when we should learn from Gandhiji. And I think we, as far as Indian traditions are concerned, yes, in old form, in our panchayats and others, we say that this kind of mediation was there. Of course, we have now taken mediation in the present form from the Western countries, from America and all, but there's always a talk that we should try to Indianize it and have indigenous values. And in this entire thing, what Gandhiji said and what we have heard today, I think we have to keep that in mind. Thank you very much.
Please, any one of you would like to ask any questions, please, you're welcome. Yes, Mr. Obroy.
Attention, this aspect also. Gandhiji, I happen to share the birthday with him. So, 2nd October, fantastic. That is, in the context of what's happening in the country, PM Modi comes from Gujarat, Gandhiji comes from Gujarat, and and whatever he did,
comes from Gujarat.
Yeah. And only thing is, not again just stressing that Sikhism and other religions also, I respect all religions. And here it may be out of place to mention a lot of the words came brotherhood. And there's something, not something, Freemasonry, I don't know. It is King Solomon. Your Lordship's mentioned, is also associated with. So a lot of these, after studying and going through all these things, there is a golden thread in all the religions and these, associations. But my one thing was to bring to your Lordship's attention the Sikhism aspect also.
Please take it.
No, here on Sikhism.
Please take it that when I spoke of the Quran, the Gita, and the Bible, I did not mean to exclude my own texts. I didn't say a word about Zoroastrianism. Right? It's in the same spirit that I did not say anything about Sikhism. All right. So, when I say those three texts, I am talking about the vast multitude of persons who exist here. And I am so glad that you brought up Sikhism, because it is equally important, if I may add, for all of you to read the Guru Granth Sahib. Equally important. And the religious texts of every great religious community. And when I singled out these three texts, I did not mean in any manner to leave out the great texts of others, least of all of my own faith. And one other interesting feature, considering that you are also born on 2nd October, let us hope that astrologically speaking, just as 30th January was a disaster, you are the opposite.
Anybody else, please? I only want to tell Mr. Roy, many of the liberals feel they all belong, they're all Gandhiji's because they come from that. So that's a different question. Thank you very much. My Lord, JP, please.
After hearing Justin Nariman, I wish I was the sugar in the bowl of milk or a sponge who can take in whatever is said today by him. I know it's so difficult to remember everything that was said, but let's nurture it over a cup of tea. Thank you so much, and let's be back exactly in 15 minutes. Thank you.